All right. Well, welcome everyone to the UVM Extension New Farmer Project webinar, Practical Poultry Production. A few logistics before we get started. If you haven't already, make sure to go through the audio setup wizard. It's under the tools menu at the top left of your screen. It only takes a minute and it will really help with your audio quality for the webinar. Also, I recommend that you close all the other applications that are open on your computer. It also helps with your webinar processing speed, so go ahead and do that. Your mics are going to be muted during this presentation, so please use the chat box, which you all have been doing very well so far, to communicate with us, with the presenter, with each other. If you have questions as we go along, go ahead and type them in the chat box, and Mike is going to catch them as he goes and answer them throughout the presentation. Also, if you haven't already, enter your email address in the chat box, and we will be sending you some follow-up information after the presentation. So our presenter this evening is Michael Derry, professor at the University of Connecticut and Extension Poultry Specialist. Dr. Derry is the lead Extension Poultry Specialist for all of New England. He obtained his BS in Animal Science from the University of Illinois and went on to obtain an MS in Animal Physiology and a PhD in Environmental Animal Physiology. He organizes and runs the New England, New York Biosecurity and Poultry Pest Management Conference. Much of his time is also devoted to providing information and help to small and part-time backyard poultry producers. Mike has also been to Vermont several times to present at our hands-on chicken slaughter workshops, so we're glad to have him joining us online this evening. Welcome, Mike.
Thank you, Jesse. So, I guess we're ready to get started. Since I really can't see everybody, I don't know where you all are and how many of you have some experience with poultry now or not, but as we go along, put your questions into the chat box there and I'll try to answer them as we go. That's going to go fairly quickly, but the slides will be up on the system, according to what Jensen said, and you'll be able to review them again as a handout and help you out. And my email will be probably on the system here somewhere. I'll put it up so you can, if you have other further follow-up questions sometime, email me and contact me that way, and we'll try to answer your questions. One of the first things for small flock people to do is determine what kind of birds they want and what they want the birds to do. So that goes into breed selection. And then we'll talk about housing and environmental management. Then we're going to talk a little bit about nutrition, and then we'll finish up talking about some health-related issues that small flock owners need to consider and think about when they're running their birds. So let's move on to, selection of your poultry stock. Some people may want to have fancy fowl because they're going to be show birds. Other people may want to have meat birds, or other people may even want to do laying birds in their backyards in themselves, or colored eggs. Depends what you want. So on the screen here, I have a few different breeds I want to show you, just to point out one. If you can see this up here, this is the Buff Cochin. They come in bantams as well as standard-sized birds, which would be, that's these birds up here. Okay. This, of course, is your Barred Plymouth Rock. I see the yellow marker here. You can see that. That's our Barred Plymouth Rock bird. These over here are Polish. We also have Houdans that are show-type birds that also have the feathers up on their head, and they kind of look like sheepdogs with feathers. And so let's just give you an idea. Now, to break this down a little further, we really have three different types of poultry. One is the show birds, like I said, and they're not really good producers, but they're fun to have around. Two is the egg-laying type birds. And that's pretty much what you're going to get when you get a barred rock, okay, or a single comb white leghorn, which is used for commercial industry, most of your white eggs. Then, of course, there's the meat type birds. This would be a Columbia type crossbird. These birds can be fairly large. They are usually all white, or now there's some red colored fowl that are used for meat production. So that's the three types of poultry we have out there. So if people are looking for different kinds, there's lots of breeders around the country that supply them. My suggestion is always buy from what's called an NPIP, National Poultry Improvement Plan Hatchery. That way you know what you get. There's over 300 breeds that are listed in the standard of perfection for types of birds that are out there that can be used for the different things we just talked about. Again, for laying, mostly the white eggs, single comb white leghorns. These came from Italy originally, and they're very prolific layers. We can get almost 300 eggs a year out of them. On standard, the commercial producers try to get 370 to 380 eggs out of a 365-day laying period. So they're pretty prolific layers. These are mostly in cages. Not too many people use these for backyard, but they're good for in a coop or inside. They're a little lighter birds, so they're not as hardy as the brown egg layers, which would be more like these. Brown eggs are usually used with sex-linked cross with a Rhode Island red on a barred Plymouth Rock female, and you end up with the black sex-linked female and this over here. And you can always tell the males are called sex-linked because when the males hatch, the little chick up here has a white spot on its head showing the barring pattern that he picked up from his mother. So the mother passes on that sex-linked trait only to the male offspring, not to its female offspring. So we know right off the bat, 100%, what the sex is. That's one of the problems with buying straight-run birds from a hatchery, say Murray McMurray. You don't know how many males or females you have until a few weeks later when they're a little bigger. That can be a problem. Meat type cross. Again, like I said, a Cornish was your standard. Right here, these are the Cornish birds, and usually crossed on a white rock or another large type bird, and you end up what we have here today, which is the modern broiler type bird. These are breeders. This is the male and female of the breeder stock. When you cross those and you take their eggs and hatch them, we end up with our broilers. Today's modern broiler can grow to about 5 pounds in 6 weeks. And they can do that on an average of about 1.65 pounds of feed per pound of live weight gain. That's in commercial industry. That's really, really fast growth and really good. Many of the backyard people who are raising meat type birds might want something a little different, maybe a little slower growing. They don't have to worry about leg problems that way. So at the end of the presentation, I have some listings of places you can buy the red birds or gray type broiler birds that are out there today. Now, just to let you know how many are out here in the United States, if we go back and talk about layer birds like these white leghorns, we have about 280 to 300 million, depending on the time of year, layers that are out there for egg laying. These are commercial egg layers, the ones you buy the eggs at the store from. Okay. When you get to the meat type birds, last year and the 2 or 3 years previous to, we've been fairly steady, we produced 8.5 billion, that's billion with a B, broiler type chicks in the United States. Now, to put that in perspective, that's hatching 1 million chicks every hour, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, just to meet the broiler supply for the United States and a little bit of other exports that we may do with these birds. This is what a typical backyard or pasture looks like around New England here. We have many different types of breeds that would be gone out there, and a fairly grassy, this is a little overgrown, but this is kind of what a grassy pasture would look like. Now, people say they want their birds out eating pasture and stuff. Normally, a bird will eat up to about 15% of its total diet on grasses or other vegetation. They're not really vegetarian animals. They're mostly omnivores. They eat a lot of things. And they usually try to eat bugs, worms, and other things. They'll eat the vegetation, but that's not what makes them grow. The vegetation actually just gives them extra xanthophyll, a little bit of vitamin and mineral, and the rest of their nutrition needs to come from a diet, which we'll talk about later. But if you have a good clean pasture like this that isn't muddy, then it's not too bad. Okay, you can house them. and some of the other specialty breeds that we have out there. For those that want colored eggs, okay, this is the true Araucana. If you look at it, they lay the blue-green type eggs. The true Araucana is rumpless. It doesn't have a tail back here. It's missing its last three coccygeal vertebrae. And it also has these side tufts up on its head so that you can really distinguish them from others. What we did in the United States, however, we changed them down to what's called the Americana. If you notice, it has a beard and it has tail feathers. That distinguishes it from the true Araucana. The only difference is disposition, a little bit of body weight, but the fact is they both lay the blue-green type eggs. A black Australorp is a very good backyard egg layer. A little heavier, so take a little more feed than a Leghorn, but they're going to be very consistent layers throughout the year. Really good ones are the sex links. The reason we have those is because they're a little heavier than a Leghorn, and they lay the brown eggs that people in New England like. Okay, again, a buff. Like I said, there's over 300 different breeds of chickens out there. These are some of the more popular ones that people use. Royal and Reds and the Barred Rocks, very popular. Again, choosing meat breeds. Some of you may want to be processing your own meat. Right now in Connecticut, there's no processors for poultry. We're working on getting a mobile processing unit for the state. However, Vermont does have a processor. Some of the other New England states, New Hampshire and Massachusetts, do have mobile poultry processing units that are out there. And they can be, I guess you can't say rented, but you can rent time with them, with other people, and get your birds processed for a small flock. There's no large commercial operations in this part of New England. Up in Vermont, however, they have opened one up that does beef in one part of the operation and poultry in the other. And I'm not sure what their hours are, how they're working right now. Jesse may know more about that, but I know they opened up recently. And here is some of the information about non-standard type, better suited for backyard broiler type birds. The Knoll Family Farm in Pennsylvania has some really good medium growing nice birds. They're Silver Cross. They get about 5 pounds in 9 weeks instead of 6 weeks. So a little slower growing, a little more flavor to them. Joe Seavey, they have the red and black, and they have a couple of good ones, again 9 to 10 weeks. And then in Shady Lane Poultry Farm, they have a few other types of breeds that may be available. Okay. The new breeds of the red that are coming from Europe, especially from France, are the gray broilers. They actually have them in Canada and they have them over in France. Here in Connecticut, they're selling them from these operators. So if you're looking for a little slower growing, really good for the pasture type bird, that's what these are. They're kind of throwbacks to what we used to have for meat type birds before we went into total housing for the chickens. Hatcheries, I mentioned NPIP, the National Poultry Improvement Plan. These are a few examples of some of the sites, but if you go to the USDA site, you can look up all the different groups that are involved in NPIP and the hatcheries. And again, this too also tells you some of the hatcheries that are out there that are participating in NPIP. The reason this is important is you'll know that they have a clean facility, they're pollutant free. They also get the vaccinations you need, especially for Merrick's disease. And you know that they're certified, so the birds are coming out good. If you don't get an NPIP certification, then you can't guarantee they're disease free. So let's move on to some of the basic needs of the breeds. Now, before I do that, are there any questions? I don't see anything coming up on the system here yet for questions about breeds. If you have questions about breeds, throw it up on the system and I'll look at it and try and answer as I go through. Let's get on to environmental factors and needs of birds then. It's pretty much what you need is what chickens need, or what chickens need is what you need. Fresh feed, we call ours food, but they need feed, they need fresh water, they need fresh air, they need light, darkness, thermal environment, protection, space. These are all things we can do. And I see there is a question out here. How do I figure out what breed I have? What online sources do you recommend? Okay, by color, you can go on to the American Poultry Association site. Just type in American Poultry Association. And they have a book called The American Standard of Perfection. They can help you with it. Or if you're not sure, send a picture, email me a picture of your breed, and I can probably tell you what it is by a picture. Are certain breeds good for certain climates? Well, if you're down south where it's really hot and warm, you want the lighter breeds, lighter feathering. If you're going to be outside, the Leghorns do well in pretty much any climate. All these birds are well for cold climates anyway. If you keep them in a house, we'll talk about that in a little bit, as far as what to put them in and to keep them. And Red Star is like a Rhode Island Red. Yes, Jeff, that's correct. The Red Star is similar to, it's a Rhode Island Red cross is what it is. It's a red sex link. That's why they're calling the Red Star. Okay, very good. Question up on vaccination, I'll talk about that when I get down to health, and that's towards the end of the thing, so if you hold off on that question, Mel, we'll get to it. Okay, so these are some of the basic needs. How do we get them? Okay, here's a picture of housing for pasture-type birds. Now, this is kind of neat what they did. They built out of poles, and they put skids on them. If you look here, you see a skid here. You can see the skids here. So these can be pulled along. There is one problem, and maybe it's when some of you guys can catch this, and you can put it on the chat thing, which you'll see is wrong. This is summertime. Okay, these birds are out along the feeder. They're doing good. But if you look at the picture, this is summertime. What do you see that might not be advantageous for birds to be in or under in summertime? Anyone catching that? If you do, put it up on the chat and see what you think it is. We'll point to it. But one of the things out here, see, they've got a little bit of grass they can chew on. They've also denuded a little bit of the ground here. Okay, no water. Well, that's not the question. They got water. Water's inside here in this little red thing. It's a hanging bell water, and this is a water bucket that feeds the bell water automatically. You're getting close to it. If you look at this up here, what's the color of that? That tarp is black. Yeah, they have shade, but this shade is black, and when the sun gets on it, what's the sun going to do? It's going to heat it up in here like an oven. That's right. So that's going to get very hot under there. So if you're going to put something like this with tarping up, use silver or white, some reflective tarp rather than a black one like this. It gets very hot in the summer underneath there, and those birds come out here rather than stay under there. So that's just one idea for housing. There's lots of other good ones. If you have a large enough flock, 30, 40 birds or more, you can take a trailer, and you can build like this one here. You notice in the back here, there's nest boxes to the back. That's set up so that you can walk to the back of the trailer, put your hand in the back of the nest box, and reach in and get the eggs without having to walk through the trailer. Here he's got a lot of roosts up here. And the thing on the bottom, he has some nice woven wire floor, which allows manure to drop. So you can move that wagon down, and the manure drops where you want it, so you can fertilize your pasture in the places you need to. The only thing I would do different on this, I would put extra wire underneath this these 2x4s. Here are 2x6s, so you have a double strand of wire. The reason for that is that if you have a varmint that gets up underneath there, someone can reach their paws through, and they'll grab a leg on a chicken, or they'll try and gnaw on it with their mouth, because that's pretty good size woven wire. I mean, it's not hard for them to cut through this and reach through. So double it up to make a floor works out pretty good. Okay, so let's move on here. These are some other modified trailers that are outside. They look pretty good. One thing you notice that, again, they congregate fairly close to the feeders and waters. They wander around the whole pasture. And here, with the ramp, you can close this up at night, and it makes a pretty good thing. Okay. Again, this shows birds on there. The reason I like the wire mesh is it helps keep their feet fairly clean. It breaks off the manure. And you got some nest boxes handmade in the corner, about a foot square. That's all they need. And it does a pretty good job. So I got some questions here. Let's see. Someone gave us some Rapanis, Quercus, I guess, and some Araucana, all hashed in May. No one's learning yet, should they be. Probably. It depends where you live. You should have them on supplemental lighting. We'll talk about that in just a little bit. Birds are long day breeders and they won't lay eggs unless they're in a long day situation. Right now we're on short days and they're getting shorter, so they're going to be destimulated and go out of production. Question. Yeah, so Luke 4, you had a question about chicken scenario. Put it up. And Amanda asked about, do we have bleed chickens in these shelters in the winter? What you can do with these, what people have done, is they're on wheels. One guy has made a kind of a greenhouse pole type barn. He actually made it using PVC piping, a fairly large pole type barn that he rolls this in. So the birds can now go on the floor in this kind of a greenhouse setup, and then at night they go back into their little trailer into a roost. So if you have the space to build that, that's really good. Otherwise, the birds really need to be have more of an enclosure in the winter, because if it gets below 30 degrees, they're going to get pretty cold. If it gets below 15 degrees, you're probably going to get some frostbite if it's damp out. So this again just shows some pictures of some good boards. Okay. I don't know if anyone's tried these or seen these, the chicken tractors. Okay. You put the broilers in, you roll them along, or you, if you're a little higher up, put some layers in. The only problem with these is if you look at them, these are TP types, and they're really tight in the corners here, so if a bird decides to lay down in the corner, the only way you're going to get is either the leg catcher, or you're going to have to lay down your belly, crawl, and get them out. My idea of housing for birds is one that, one, it's dry and draft free, especially for the winter time, and two, it's something that's easy for you to get into and you to clean, as well as for the birds to do. So a couple more pictures here. So here's a pretty good idea for a permanent setup. Okay. here we see on the ground down here, this is kind of dirt in there now, and when it rains, what's going to happen to that? It's going to turn to mud. The problem with mud is that then you bring worms up, and worms carry disease, so you got to be very careful with that. This fencing is okay. Again, I would double up on both sides of the post for fencing so animals can't get through. He's got some covering over here to put shade. He's got a nice little door here to get in and out of, and an easy door over here for the human to get in and out of and collect eggs and do what they need to do. What I would do with this run, however, I would either dig down a little bit and put some pea gravel in, or put some boards along the side here and raise it up and then put pea gravel in. The reason I like pea gravel is it drains very well, it's small diameter, and it doesn't hurt their feet when they walk on it. So it works really, really good. Okay, and you can wash it down. Pea gravel is easy to wash out and clean every day, and then when the sun gets on it, it keeps it clean. Anyone seen some dog runs or other runs that have pea gravel, you know, they work really good. We have a few game bird operations around here that also use pea gravel in their runs, and it keeps them really clean and nice to work with. You don't get the mud in the summer and winter that you do with these, so that can be a problem. Again, just some nest boxes, generally one nest box for every 4 to 5 hens, about a cubic foot with a nice little opening. And you can either put litter inside there, or some people actually put in like that fake turf grass, the carpeting that looks like turf grass, and that works pretty good. It's something you can clean, something that you can sanitize, works really well. Okay. Shredded paper is okay. The trouble, what you got to do with shredded paper is it gets wet real quick, and if it gets wet, then it'll turn into paper mache, so make sure you clean it out on a regular basis. And you need a lot of shredded paper, probably pretty cheap. So if you clean it out every other day, it's probably not much of a mess. Again, here, another roosting area, just get an idea. Now, if you just have 4 or 5 hens, here's a nice idea for a type of tractor that you can pull around your yard. And notice their nice lush green grass. I don't think it's just because of the chickens, though. Here's another view of the same operation. This is the front view. It's got the nice little ramp here for the birds to get up in. He's got hanging feeder that he drops down and a water system over here. It's pretty easy to clean. She goes in the back. She can have a roosting area and collect the eggs. So this is a pretty nice little setup, again, custom built. You've probably seen these around. They have a lot of these. for sale at commercial places, anywhere from $400 up to $1,000. I've seen these things. They're okay. You can probably build your own a lot cheaper. The nice thing about this is it has the nest boxes right alongside here, reach in and grab. The only problem with this design, if you look at the bottom here, the nest boxes are right even with the floor, and they're constantly kicking dirty litter in or they kick the litter out. My idea would be to raise these nest boxes up just a little bit higher so you have a few inches and they don't end up getting as much material into them. Now this is the condo of the chicken houses. This is a nice one because this raises it off the ground, makes it harder for predators to get up into there and climb in. They have a nice little ramp and a door that closes, again on either end. It has a door down here that you can get into and work easy. The nest boxes are here. If you notice, they're actually raised off the bottom of the floor just a little bit. It works really good. And of course, they have the garage down here that can park their Porsche in. Now, what I do like about this run is it is mostly stone. The trouble is some of this is sharp gravel. And if anyone's had chickens on sharp gravel before, you know there's potential for them to cut the bottom of their feet, and then they end up with a problem called bumblefoot, which you don't really want. So the pea gravel is a little better, but at least they're getting the hang of it here. This is a nice design, custom-built facility. Now here's some better-looking ones. If you're really artistic, this is an architect here in Connecticut has designed a few of these. The only problem I see is his runs. They have just a single mesh wire here of chicken wire, the PVC piping. I'll show you another view of these. This is the front view. Here's another one, a little store that Cassie built. You can see he used the PVC piping to make his hoop area. I would get a little thicker, double this up. He does have sand in here. He cleans it and rakes it, keeps it very nice. So, I mean, this guy is retired and has plenty of time to do this with his chickens. I think he's got a dog in the yard, too, that helps protect, so he doesn't double wire up. But my recommendation is be careful. And here's the inside of one of them. They look pretty good, nice and white. He actually had, I think, a 60-watt lamp in there, way too bright. I told him to cut that down, put a small compact fluorescent in there, because all that white in there, you're going to go blind looking at it. So for housing, bottom line, dry and draft-free. You want something simple that you can work with, that the birds have access to their nest boxes, to their roosting material, and you can clean out fairly easily. Now, I like wood litter, okay? The reason I like it, wood absorbs moisture, and then it re-releases moisture. Okay? And as it dries out, it also helps kill some of the bacteria because of the taking the water out of it. The other thing about litter, I know it sometimes turns like a brown or a darker color, and people think, well, now it's dark and dirty, got to throw it out. No, you don't, because it's starting to compost a little bit. As long as it still absorbs moisture and re-releases moisture, it's still viable. Just top dress with a little bit of fresh rather than trying to totally clean out all the time. The only time you really need to clean out is if your birds have disease, okay, or if you're putting a fresh flock in. Then you want to do a total clean out and wash out. We'll talk about that in a little bit under biosecurity and cleaning. But, so, wood litter works really good. Wood shavings. Okay, I don't want sawdust that's too dusty, and you don't want something that doesn't re-release moisture back into the air and get rid of it, because if you have wet litter, then you're going to be prone for diseases like coccidiosis. Deep bedding is fine, okay? Deep bedding is good to start with, and you just rake through it. You take a garden rake, and as your litter, you know, once or twice a week, take your garden rake through the litter and just rake it through and kind of break it up. Add a little bit of fresh as you need to keep it dry. If you have ammonia, if you smell ammonia, then you have wet litter. You have a problem. Or in the wintertime, you don't have enough ventilation. You do need to ventilate and keep air moving. So you should have a window and a cross ventilation if you can to get the air out. Okay? Hay. Somebody asked about using hay. The reason I don't like hay or straw is when it gets wet, okay, it doesn't dry out very fast, okay, and then you can get, you can get mold growing in it. And if they suck in the mold, they can get a disease called aspergillosis. However, that being said, if you have access to lots of straw or hay and it's real cheap and you're cleaning out every other day or so, then you're not going to have to worry about it. You can use it. And they will eat it and play with it. Again, don't let it get moldy. Don't let it get real wet. Okay? Good points. Some feeders. You've probably all seen all different kinds of feeders. I don't have any particular preference that I say one is better than the other. What you want to make sure any feeder or water you have is something that's washable, okay, and sanitizable. That's the main thing. The other thing is, if you look at all the feeders and waters, here's the lip on this one, here's the lip on this one, here's the lip on this one. If you're looking around up in the top, going from the top left to right as you're looking, okay, this one over here, the Shenandoah, without a big cover on it, that one is an indoor feeder. This is an indoor feeder. The ones that look like they have covers over them, these are outdoor feeders. Now, the reason I pointed to the lip, you always want to have your feeders and your waters so that the lip on the feeder water is even with the flat of the back of the bird when they stand up. And the reason for that is it makes them work a little to get their head in there and eat, and two, when they accidentally back up to it, they don't poop directly into their feed. Now, they may try to stand on it, and this has an anti-roosting device up on top of the long trough feeder in the blue there. Okay, that keeps the birds from standing on there and pooping into it, too. So you keep raising them up. So that means with this type of trough feeder, you're going to have to put some sort of block or something under it. Most of these other ones, with the blocks on them outside, or for this type of Shenandoah, way up in the top corner without the hood on it, that can be hung with chains. Also, you can use it inside if you want. And that keeps them from roosting in there and getting their poop in and keep it clean. So that's feeders. When you put feed in, make sure that the feed in the trough where the birds are, where they can feed from, is no more than halfway full. If you start overfilling it, they just throw your feed out and waste it. You don't want to do that. Okay. Waterers, all kinds of waters. There's galvanized ones over here with the blue background, and then of course I got a couple 5 and 3 gallon plastic waterers. These are all good for year-round use. Just got to keep them clean. Again, like I said, once a week you should rinse your waterers out, clean out your stuff so you don't get a scum buildup and bacteria building up in it. For wintertime, that's when they really need water, because it's so dry, they're losing moisture faster than in the summer when it's humid out. So what you need to do here is you can get this water heater. You can use it on the plastic ones or the galvanized ones. This only gets to about 55 degrees, just enough to keep the water from freezing. So they should have free access to water 24/7. That's something important. Now, this guy was pretty novel about his. If you look at it close in the picture, you can see that he has a gutter on the roof of this building here, and he's got a rain barrel collecting rainwater, and he's feeding the rainwater, okay, to the chickens. The problem with this, any birds that are flying up on top up here and land on it and leave their poop, any wild birds, anything else, that manure may have bacteria in it, and that bacteria now gets in the water, and now you have an enriched solution here going into your birds. I'm not sure this is such a good idea if you don't have a way to purify or clean the water. Okay, I know it seems pretty cheap and easy, but there's cheaper ways. But for a few gallons of water, I'd rather get clean water. Got a question here. Can chickens survive by eating snow? It's really pretty cold. It chills them. They don't really eat too much snow, but yes, they could get some moisture that way. They probably get very cold when it's that cold out to do that, and they won't drink as much or won't get as much water for the volume, so it's not really good. Okay, let's move forward. And someone asked about feed, and we're going to talk about nutrition just a little bit. Let me talk about some environmental factors, because if your birds are going to be outside, they're exposed to all these. One, sunlight. Birds can get sunstroke or heat stroke and sunburn, believe it or not. So you need to provide good shade. Someone brought that up earlier. You want to make sure they have shade so they can in and out as they need to. Okay. Temperature. Want to know how hot or how cold can your bird stand? Okay, well, we have upper and lower limits. Lower limit, like I said, when it gets below 30 degrees, it's pretty cold out. When it gets below 15 degrees Fahrenheit. That's when you can probably see a little more possibility of freezing a comb in wattles and stuff, especially if it's very humid out. For that, make sure that you have enough bird density that they can huddle up inside their coop, or they have a couple of birds that will sit in a nest box together and keep warm. Again, if they're out of a draft and they're dry, they can pretty much go down to 0 degrees Fahrenheit without having supplemental heat. But below 15 degrees is when most people want to put some supplemental heat in. At that point, you want to put some sort of infrared heater in if you can, or a heat lamp. Just keep your birds from really, really freezing. And generally, that's only a few days a year that you have to worry about that, so it shouldn't hurt their production or anything. Again, like I said, draft-free, that's what you don't want the wind in there, okay? If you can keep them out. Now, in the summertime, you don't mind a little moisture because it helps cool them, and you don't mind a little breeze. It's mostly for winter that you have to worry about these things. However, in the summer we do get rain, and when it rains out, they need to have access to get out of the rain if they want. Now, some birds will go out and run around in it, and they'll try and eat worms because that's when they come out, and others they'll look at the rain and be afraid of it and don't know what to do, and they'll stay in their coop. I don't think we're going to get mud or dust this much anymore, at least I hope we don't, but anyway, you can get dust and mud, and that can be a harbor of bacteria that's just being airborne and carried on the dust particles. Plus, it can irritate their eyes if their nictitating membrane isn't functioning right, and it gets in their feed and everything else. So, again, keeping the environment clean is the best you can do. Predators. That's a real problem. Okay, you can have predators in the ground, coyotes, foxes, dogs, cats, fisher cats here in Connecticut and up north here in New England, I'm sure. We have owls, we have other birds of prey. And then, of course, there may be toxic plants. If you're putting your birds out in pasture, double check to make sure you don't have any toxic plants, because if they eat a toxin, sometimes that's not really good for them. It can knock them down. Some are neurotoxins, and they're going to go down pretty quick. So let me get to lighting real quickly here. The reason we light birds, okay, is because, one, it helps them see. Two, it stimulates their cycles. Like I said, chickens are long day breeders. That means when springtime comes, it stimulates them to want to lay eggs. Okay? And because of that, they're stimulated due to hormone release, and that's what they need. So here's some tips on lighting. If you have meat birds, generally what you can do, okay, you can put them on light from day 1 to 3, about 20 to 23 hours of light a day. Never give them 24 hours of light. Let them see some darkness. The reason why, chickens develop fear after 3 days of age. The first 3 days of age, they're pretty much fearless. And once raised chicks knows, they come up to your hand, you can hold them, carry them around. If you handle them a lot during that first 3 days, if you imprint with them, then they'll follow you around and stay with you pretty much throughout their time. However, if you give them an hour of darkness or so, okay, they get used to that, and then they're not afraid of it. If you give them that hour or two of darkness when they're first couple of days old. If you don't, if you put them on 24 hours of light, now you're thinking, well, I've got to put them on a heat lamp so they're going to have light. Yes, but it's not broad spectrum light, so it doesn't affect them the same way. Okay, I'm talking about white light. If they see that, then they tend to be afraid. Okay, so you can use your heat lamps or infrared, but don't use white lights for 24 hours if you can avoid it. And then from day 4 to processing between 18 and 20 hours a day if you want to get your birds out. Now, for backyard type rearing, if you just want to use natural day length and you've slowed your the growth down, you're not worried about processing real fast, then pretty much 12 hours a day is fine. You can let them go because they're not breeders. All you want them to do is eat, so they can be on natural light as long as you want them to be on. Layers are another story. Again, for layers early on, from day 4 to 13 weeks, they shouldn't see more than about 10 hours of light. Now, that's not always easy to do year-round, so when you have in the backyard and you get them at different times of the year and it may be increasing or decreasing, then what you need to do is, once they hit production at about 18 weeks of age, just put them on 16 hours of light. They'll eventually adapt to it, and you get good production throughout the year. And what I like to do for this is, for 16 hours of light, go from 5 a.m. to 9 a.m. in the morning. So put your light on a timer, 5 a.m. to 9 a.m. By then, by 9 a.m., sun's out, it's pretty bright out, so they have access to daylight, they're going to see that. And then about 4 p.m. in the evening, turn it back on and shut it off at 9 p.m. at night. Then you're going to get the longest day of the year, you're still going to be within those two time periods, and the birds never see increase or decrease at either end of the day, and they'll maintain pretty good egg production for you throughout the year. So I hope that answered your question on hours of light. It's in there, okay? Again, for duration, never increase the duration or intensity during the growing period if you can. And this is for layers, and don't decrease the duration or intensity during the production period. If you can avoid it, you're going to end up doing a much better growing job and get more eggs out of your birds. Okay, some people want to know about culling. That means getting the birds that are not layers out of your flock. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this because I have this here and you can get access to this and look at it. But basically, we're looking at these characteristics. A good layer, okay, usually has pretty good comb and wattles, and her abdomen is soft and she's got flexible wide pubic bones. So there's two bones that stick out right across the vent where the egg comes out. And the vent should be large, moist, and bleached. And as far as bleaching goes, this means for birds that have normally yellow shanks, they would look more white. They're losing that color, it's going into the yolk. Okay, so this is some characteristics of layers and non-layers and how to tell which one they are. And this order of bleaching, now this is for leghorn or yellow skinned birds, this shows you about how long they've been laying eggs as to how far they're bleached out. And when they come out of production, they follow the same pattern except twice as fast. Okay, so they come back, the color comes back faster than it goes out. In molting, if you have birds that aren't feather picking, pulling all feathers out, sometimes you can look at the wings and determine molt. During molt, they usually drop in production too. Okay, so that's that part of choosing a breed and housing and some environmental factors. Any quick questions on that before we move into nutrition? Okay, I got a question about management to make a molt go faster. You can actually force molt a bird and in about 6 weeks they're back in production again. And to force molt, what we usually do is we weigh the birds, get an idea what their body weight is, and then take feed away until they've lost about 10 to 12% of that body weight. If they're really heavy and they're kind of going out of production, and then you put them back on the feed and you slowly bring them up on feed. Don't give them too much free choice right off the bat because they'll slowly, they don't want to overeat and overfill when you first put feed back on. But never, never take water away. And the other thing to do a forced molt, so you take the feed away and you drop the hours of light down to about 8 hours a day if you can. So the winter time is a good time to do a molt. However, it's cold, so you may have to do heat lamps or you have to get them in an area that you can keep warm if they're losing their feathers so they don't chill. So generally, backyard flocks just do a partial molt on their own, go in and out, and after about 2 years, their egg productions drop really, really low. Are there negative effects to the bird when using artificial light to increase laying? No, it just increases the number of eggs that you want that you're going to get. They're going to naturally decrease production as they get older anyway, whether you have them on stimulatory lighting or not. So that's just what we do to commercially to maintain egg production throughout them. If you want to maintain egg production for yourself, if you're trying to sell to neighbors or anything, you're going to lose eggs in the winter if you don't maintain this type of lighting. So nutrition, very quickly. I'm going to tell you right off the bat, buy bagged feed or buy bulk feed if you have enough birds that you can get from a commercial feed mill. Otherwise, trying to mix your own feed at home and doing scratch feed, you're not going to get production out of it and it's going to cost you more. The reason why is because commercially, they have all the nutrients and all the feed stuffs that they need to make a perfect feed. So there's lots of companies, lots of name brand companies out there that sell bag feed for layers, broilers, waterfowl, turkeys, you name it, it's out there. Now, what are the needs? Same thing we need. Carbohydrates, protein, fat, minerals, water, oxygen. These are all things that we need and the birds need. And if you can imagine having a perfectly balanced diet, perfectly balanced meal every day of your life, that's what we're trying to give chickens by giving them complete rations, okay? The chick requires 13 different vitamins. These are some of the things that they look for, okay? 13 amino acids, there's one essential fatty acid they have to have, and they need sources of energy, okay? In order to supply all this properly, it's really just good to get the feed that a poultry nutritionist has formulated and that is being mixed at the mill and bagged up. This is what most of your feedstuffs come from, cereal grains, animal, some animal proteins, sometimes they use in meat and bone meal, okay? The fact that they can't use meat and bone meal in cattle feeds now has made it more available for poultry feeds. They don't have to worry about mad cow disease in chickens because we don't have a mad chicken disease yet. We have a few angry chickens, but we don't have mad chickens. Okay, so then the vegetable and all the different things. So I'm going to show you what a ration kind of looks like. This is typical laying hen diet that goes in. This is pretty much commercial corn, soybean meal, a little salt. The D-L-methionine here, okay, this is one of the essential amino acids that they have to have that they don't get in good balance from eating anything in the wild very easily, okay, they'd have to eat other birds and be cannibalistic or need a lot of meat to get the methionine. So we supplement a little bit extra of that. The lysine is also another amino acid that we supplement. This gives them excellent egg production and excellent meat production for meat birds when we add some of these, especially meat birds will add methionine. Okay, and this is for different weeks of lay, 21 to 24, 39 to 41, and then 59 to 62 weeks, we change diets. Now this is commercial. For you guys, you're going to end up buying a laying hen diet, and that's what you're going to feed throughout the time. You're not going to be putting extra money out trying to change diets every few weeks. Okay. So, I had a question here. At what age should they molt? Generally, chickens molt when they're getting close to a year of lay. About after they've been in lay for about 45 to 60 weeks, anytime in that period, you can molt them. Otherwise, chickens molt pretty much in the fall when they're approaching their first year of age. Okay, depends on, again, where you are and what you're doing with them and things like that. A good way to add protein to heritage layers because they have feather picking. Well, protein isn't necessarily the reason they're feather picking. Sometimes they're feather picking because they're bored. So you can do environmental enrichments. An environmental enrichment would be like taking a head of cabbage, putting a string through it, hanging it in your shed or your poultry building, and putting a few of those out, and they go out and peck at it. They play keep away at the leaves. The other thing is you can get like soda cans or Coca-Cola cans, bright red. They're attracted to that. They'll go peck at it. They make noise. Put a couple of little stones and rocks in it. So when they hit it, it sounds like a rattle. They'll have a lot of fun with that. That attracts them and helps keep them from feather picking and fighting. That's one of the things you can do. If you're seeing excessive feather picking, check and see, you know, how much space you have for your birds. Generally, inside a building, you want anywhere from 1 to 2 square foot for standard layers. In a floor type building, and outside on pasture, you know, people say anywhere up to 300 chickens per acre. That's quite a few. I would go 60 to 100 per acre. So that way you're not overgrazing and you don't have too crowded. Okay. Somebody added about electric fencing, keeping animals in then keeping animals out. Depends on the fencing and where you put them in and how high you put them up. If you put double strand of a little electric wire and put one at about 2 or 3 inches above the ground, the other about 6 inches up the ground. Some of these animals, the fisher cats, may sit there and think that's fun to get tickled with electricity, and they may jump over it, but many other animals, they tend to hit it and then they get zapped until they go away. The other good thing to put in is a light on a timer, or a light on a motion sensor in your yard. So if anything comes in that shouldn't be there, the light comes on, tends to stun them, scare them a little bit, and they tend to go away. Once they notice that nothing's around after a while, they may just, you know, avoid the light and just go somewhere else. It doesn't matter. But on nutrition, I don't want to spend a lot of time because the best thing to do is buy complete feed. If you have a good feed, you should have all the protein you need for the birds. Okay, if you need to supplement protein, you can get a little extra soybean meal. You can add it to the diet. In the wintertime, when it's cold, the supplement that I recommend is either corn oil, a little bit of corn oil, top dressed on your feed about an hour before lights out, or cracked corn at no more than 5% of the total intake for the day. And do that at night. What happens, corn is very high in energy, and that gets into the crop and slowly goes through the bird at night. So for the next 2 or 3 hours, they're getting that heat of metabolism that keeps them warmer. That's what we do in our farm here at UConn. We add a little bit of cracked corn at night when it's really cold, and that keeps our birds healthy and warm and in production. Okay. That's about shelf life of commercial feed. Okay. When you buy lots of feed, anything over about 2 or 3 months is too old. What happens is vitamins can lose some of their potency over time. Even chelated ones that are held in, they can tend to lose potency, and you want to be careful of that. Plus, how you store it is very important. When you store feed, small amounts and stuff, what I do is I get like a galvanized garbage can. And the reason galvanized, because it's harder for rodents to eat through it, and then put a plastic garbage can or plastic bag, heavy bag, inside that, and then put your bag of feed inside that. Now you've insulated it, you're not going to get it wet, and it's not going to change temperatures and get wet and moldy. And it also protects it from rodents and other things to get in there, because that's the major attractant is the feed. And then when you lay it out, it should be going through it. If you buy lots and lots of feed and store it for a long period of time, you could get moldy, and you could lose some of the vitamin potency. So I hope that answers your question about that. If you have several people that you can share feed with, you guys want to go in and buy feed, you know, in bulk, and somebody's back a pickup truck and then bag it yourself, if you have enough people in a region, then that's a good way to save money, because bag feed is very expensive compared to buying in bulk. So anything over about 2 or 3 months, I would be suspect of, okay? So, let's move on, since it's almost 8 o'clock here. We've got a few minutes. Let's go over disease prevention and management of poultry flocks. Okay, this is an area that may scare some people off, or may wonder, you know, what am I getting into? Do they have as many diseases as my kids do? If you have kids or other animals, you know that there's potential, and that's the key word, potential. Doesn't mean you're always going to get it. But there's potential for several diseases, and I think if you're informed going in, it helps you become a better manager, and you don't have the problems when you know what you're getting into. So, let's move forward a little bit here. Again, successful flock is a result of good breeding stock. Like I said, MPIP, you know they're healthy, you're getting them. Good management, good disease control, good feeding, and maintaining, you know, a good environment for the birds. You're going to have fewer and fewer problems to worry about, and you have a lot of enjoyment out of your chickens. Number one is prevention, and you prevent by keeping your facility sanitized and away from disease, and two, by using proper vaccinations. Now, for most backyard flocks, the only vaccinations you'll ever get are what you get from the hatchery. And again, I recommend Marek's disease. We'll talk about that. M-A-R-E-K-S, Marek's disease vaccine from the hatchery. And if there's other diseases prevalent in your area, okay, if you've been to a poultry vet, or if you know that in your area you may have had bronchitis, laryngotracheitis, coryza, or some of the other frequently seen respiratory type diseases, you might get a vaccination at the hatchery for that, but you won't be able to do a booster. Most vaccines come in either 10,000 or 1,000 dose vials, and they're very expensive if you only have a few birds. So that's the best you can do there. Okay. The other vaccine you can do, and that's for coccidiosis now. Coccidia is a parasite that gets into the birds. They have 9 different types of coccidia, okay, and these are protozoan. They're not bacteria, they're not vira, there's something called a protozoan, and there's 9 different types. And what many hatcheries have now is they have a service called CoccyVac, C-O-C-C-I-V-A-C, coxievac. Okay, and it may cost 10 to 15 cents a bird to have the coxievac sprayed on the birds, but then you don't need medicated starter feed. So if you have baby chicks and you're rearing them, you do want to do coccidiosis control, because that's pretty much rampant and it's prevalent. Any bird outside is going to get coccidiosis probably one time or another, and you just want to make sure that you keep the birds healthy. And again, coccivac, you don't need to use medicated starter feeds. Okay? Control. Treat birds as they get sick, or eliminate disease, or eliminate the birds from the flock if they're sick so the other ones don't get it. Now we're going to talk about these just a little bit. The commercial industry moved to inside housing for a reason, because when you have thousands of birds and you're trying to produce a lot of eggs or a lot of meat to feed, you know, 6 billion people in the world, we had to bring them inside to keep them from getting disease and problems and just a lot of other issues. But one of the big things is, think about it. If your birds are outside, just like you would be, you're exposed to every potential problem that any bird that flies over or any rodent that crawls through your yard, any disease they can bring in, then your birds are being exposed and potentially susceptible to it. So how do we reduce that? One, okay, again, by breeding, by getting from good breeding stock. Like I said, if they're healthy to start with, sunlight does a really good job of killing a lot of viruses and bacteria outside, okay? And so that's really good. When the sun isn't out and it's rainy and nasty, that's when bacteria and viruses tend to thrive. So that's the same thing for chickens. If it's kind of wet and nasty out and not really sunny out, then there's more viral problems floating around that you have to watch out for. Again, we talked about the vaccination. Sanitation, we'll talk about cleaning and disinfecting at the end here a little bit. But one of the things you can do is keep your feeders and waterers clean. And if you do have wet litter, keep the litter dry, clean it out as you need to. If you're getting high ammonia in there, you have wet litter, you need to get it dry, and you need to ventilate. Next thing is practicing integrated pest management. That's IPM. Integrated pest management means using all the different methods available, cultural, mechanical, chemical, and physical methods, okay, to prevent rodents and insects from getting into your building where they shouldn't be. Okay, that's what you want to do. So you can get rat traps, you can get rat bait, you can get stations. There's a lot of things out there to keep rodents away. One of the problems with chickens and their feed is they do tend to attract rodents. Now, if you're in the backyard, you're saying, well, you know, I'm in a neighborhood somewhere, and I don't want rodents coming in. I want my neighbors saying I'm bringing rodents in. Any animal outside, dogs, cats, and all them, they're leaving manure or feed around outside. They're also attracting rodents. So you're no worse than anyone else. But just have to keep an eye on it and make sure. The biggest thing is biosecurity. We'll talk about that. Basically, that means do not let someone that has just been to another poultry farm walk on your poultry farm without having showered or changed clothes, or at least wearing boots so they don't bring in disease from that farm into yours. I mean, the worst thing you hear about is the postman that was just down the road comes to your place dropping a package off and says, hey, your chickens look really good today, but the guy down the road that just dropped a package off, his are all dying off. What just happened to your flock? He just brought everything they had to you. So really kind of think about it if you want to maintain a good, healthy flock. Now, I'm sure by now pretty much everyone's heard of avian influenza the last few years. That has been a potential threat, and then they switched it over from avian influenza recently to swine flu, but it's pretty much the same type of virus, maybe transmitted from birds to humans. We haven't seen it here in the U.S., the type that's zoonotic, that goes from animals to humans early 1900s, but there's always that threat, so you want to be careful with it. But the symptoms and signs are that the birds kind of look very lethargic, laying down like this one over here in the bottom corner is. And then they get some dark looking combs. They get very, very quiet. Okay, they don't make a lot of noise. They lay down, you hear wheezing and gasping, and pretty soon they're just dropping over dead. That's a really severe case of AI. In Connecticut, we have an AI surveillance program. If birds die and you're not sure what they died from, we have a free diagnostic service at the Connecticut Veterinary Diagnostic Laboratory, where they'll do a necropsy, the first necropsy, to look at it and see if it if it came from avian influenza. NPIP hatcheries also monitor and select against avian influenza. So you know you're going to have AI-free birds coming from an NPIP hatchery also. That's something to think about. Other diseases. There's viral, bacterial, or what we call mycoplasma type diseases that can be passed along. So just to show you a few, and just so you're aware where these come from, fall cholera, avian pastoralosis. You don't see much of it, but sparrows, pigeons, and rats can carry it. And if you've been watching the news lately or listening to, you know Haiti has a cholera outbreak. Cholera generally comes from contaminated drinking water. It means manure got into it, and the birds or humans or whatever are drinking it, and that's how they can get cholera. So it's the same way. E. coli. E. coli is actually fairly common. You get small amounts of it, and sometimes they get a little diarrhea from it. And it's usually not really bad, but it throws them off. That's wild birds and mammals carry it. Now, if your birds do get a little case of diarrhea, the best thing to do is first treat the dehydration that will occur from that. So put them on an electrolyte type solution. For just two or three birds in the backyard, Pedialyte, the same stuff they use for infants and children, is really good electrolyte solution. One, it's sterile, and you get the plain one, not the flavored one. And you know, it's sterile, and it's a perfect mix of electrolytes for the birds. If you have more than just a few birds, you got 50 or 60 birds, then you're going to go buy the powdered electrolyte solution, and you're going to end up putting that in your drinking water and hope that you have clean drinking water. Okay. Sometimes you get E. coli if you don't have cleaned out water systems. So keep them clean so you don't get it. Because E. coli is naturally around there. It's in manure, and you can see it. Fowl pox, usually brought in by wild type birds. We haven't seen much fowl pox, but there's two types, and I'll show you a couple pictures of it later on here, I think. You can get the dry pox on the skin and wet pox in your mouth. Histaminiasis. Generally see this in turkeys. We also call it blackhead. It comes from the heterichous worm. Earthworms carry this worm. So do grasshoppers. What happens is chickens can get the heterichous worm. They don't show necessarily signs of histaminiasis, okay, or blackhead, but then they pass them on manure, and if the turkey's in the same manure, or you walk from chickens to turkeys and they have it, then you pass the worm on to them. Now the turkeys can probably get it. We don't have a lot of good treatments for histaminiasis anymore. Paratyphoid, we don't see much of that, so I wouldn't worry about it, but that's potential, something you could see. Mycoplasma, that MG, Mycoplasma gallisepticum, and Mycoplasma synovia they can get. Again, airborne, chickens, turkeys, guinea fowl, ducks, pigeons, everything can get it. Okay, so you just want to be real careful with that. Campylobacteriosis, we don't see much of that in birds, but what I want to put this one on here for is Campylobacter is a bacteria that humans can get sick with, and they can end up getting really bad case of diarrhea. So that's what I'm saying. Okay, question here. What are the symptoms of histaminiasis? Okay, blackhead, they get kind of a blue or dark colored cyanotic head looking on the turkeys. They look really bad. They get lethargic and go down. And that's what it is. It's due to the heterichous worm. Okay, so if you have turkeys and you see their heads really turning a dark color blue, you see them getting really lethargic, okay, and they're kind of down, they're not moving very well, you might want to have them tested to see what they have. They have some sulfa drugs that they try to treat it with. Okay, so if you have an avian vet or a veterinarian nearby that can check it out or look at it, that's the best thing to do if you have those potentials. Email me later if you think you do. Okay, we'll get in contact with you. Staph, encephalomyelitis, you don't see too much of that, just falling in the brain. Newcastle disease, I don't know if anyone remembers, just a few years ago they had a Newcastle outbreak going from California towards the Mississippi River. You know, it hit several states and several million birds were depopulated because we had Newcastle disease. That can be brought in on parakeets, parrots. Most of the citizen type birds that are brought in illegally tend to have Newcastle. So if someone's, you know, someone that has a parrot that they bought on the black market, shall we say, chances are that bird might be sick. So don't go from that bird to your birds unless you want to have a chance at carrying Newcastle. Okay, some of the other diseases and things we want to talk about here. Okay, external parasites, lice and mites. Okay, here's some feather lice. You can see the little spots I put on here. Those are the nits on the feathers. Okay, they irritate the birds pretty good. Here's some mites on the birds. You can see the little dots on here that move around. And then the internal parasites I'll talk about are worms. These are roundworms. This is what a roundworm infection looks like. This is in their intestine. We open up the intestine of the bird, and these little worm, fed-like worms come out. And that's why we want to deworm a couple times a year, and we'll talk about that in just a minute. So let's talk about these external parasites. They can come from other animals, too. Come pretty quick. Worms come from earthworms, okay, cockroaches, grasshoppers. Ducks and geese are potential carriers. Ducks and geese, you don't see too much problem with them. They seem to have a much better immune system to worm problems. I guess it's because they're living on lakes and water areas all the time. But chickens do have some problems. They have decreased production. If you have a heavy worm infestation, your chickens tend to go pale, and they drop in egg production. And we'll talk about treatment in just a minute here, okay? I don't see too many tapeworms. There's not many medications. There's only one valbenazine. It's albendazole, albendazole, that can be used for tapeworms. However, it's only by prescription. So you have to get your veterinarian to write a prescription to use that, okay? We talked about poisons and toxins from poisonous plants that can be a real problem. There are some other specific health problems that we need to deal with hitting different areas like respiratory system or the digestive system. So let me move forward on that. Aspergillosis we talked about. Comes from moldy litter, hay, straw. We see a lot of this on cattle or horse farms where there's extra hay and straw laying around that isn't cleaned up and the birds are running through it and they get it. Okay? Keep things clean. Spray the house with copper sulfate as needed. So it's on the slide here so you can see that. Again, we talked about vaccinating for Merrick's disease, okay? That's a cancer of chicken caused by virus. So that's why you want to vaccinate early on. If they do have it, sometimes they get leg paralysis. They get a tumor on the sciatic nerve, and it causes the leg not to move, and they spraddle it out, and next thing you know, they're down, and inside the bird, they have little tumors growing all over inside their body. Again, there's no treatment, and you have to vaccinate only at day of age. Anything past that, it doesn't vaccinate, doesn't work. So it has to be either in the egg at 18 days in the hatchery they do it now. They actually inject the eggs with the vaccine, or they do it just after they hatch. So that's a couple of ways you get the vaccine. This is kind of what it looks like. Okay, this one right over here with this thing flashing on, okay, on that arrow, okay. That is a sciatic nerve that is swollen. It's all swollen up because it has the Merrick's disease on there. This is a normal one. This is what the bird looks like with Merrick's. It's paralyzed. It doesn't move around. The other problem with Merrick's is they can get ocular problems. If you look at this eye here, you notice it's very large and funny looking. That bird has Merrick's and it can create blindness. One of the other problems we have, some respiratory diseases, they all show very similar symptoms. And that's of sneezing, gasping. Rails is that kind of funny sound that they'll make like they're trying to clear their throat. That's what railing means. Gasping is like they're gasping for air. What we have with bronchitis, besides the hard respiratory breathing, you end up with some funny looking shells sometimes and a decrease in egg production. It's spread pretty much by the air and it comes from feather dander from the other birds and stuff. So, so it gets around pretty quick. If you have it, you can treat sometimes secondary infection, but this is a bird with the bronchitis, and these are what the misshapen eggs look like. They're not really good. Laryngo, we don't see too much of this. Backyard flocks, every once in a while, they get a mild case of it. It's different from bronchitis because it's higher up in the respiratory system, and they get the little problems, they get blood in the trachea. And so the trachea and these little spots here, this is all blood. These are blood spots inside the trachea. When they cough sometimes, they cough up blood. So if they have a really bad case of laryngo, you end up with some blood spots. Okay? Fowl pox. This is what I said. There's a couple of them. You might see it. mosquitoes, while birds are carriers. They look just like pox. We have chicken pox. Chickens get fowl pox. I didn't name them. I don't know who did, but that's the way it is. And so they get sores and they're threatened. Here's what they look like. This bird has pox marks up on its head up here, right under the eye, right here, big black one up there. Then these little lesions here inside its mouth. These are all the pox. When they get wet pox, sometimes they get so many of these lesions in their mouth and their throat that they can't breathe and they suffocate. Again, there's not much you can do. This is a viral infection. Antibiotics don't really work. What happens is sometimes the birds, like any other viral infection, they go through it and they come back as if they're vaccinated. So they usually, if they survive it, they're usually okay. They have a drop in production, but they usually survive. Same thing with infectious bronchitis or laryngotracheitis. If they have a case of it, you isolate your birds, hope they get through it, and then when they get through it, they end up being vaccinated. But eventually, if you have one bird in your flock with it and you left them there, they're all going to get it. So now we'll talk about worming and deworming, some of the internal parasites, coccidiosis. Again, I talked about coccidia. It's that protozoa. And usually there's several different type of agents you can use. Amprol in the water or Amprol in the feed. That's what's in your medicated starter feed. Generally, it's Amprolium. There's a few other drugs that are out there, some sulfa drugs and other things that people use. You can also use Amprolium if you have waterfowl. You can use a medicated chick starter feed in your waterfowl. There's some myths out there that say that, oh no, you can't use Amprol for waterfowl, it kills them. Not really. The only ones that would kill the birds, kill the waterfowl, are the ones that arsenic, the arsenicals, which people used to use. So don't use that. Okay? And this is what coccidiosis does inside the birds. These are things called the cica. Inside their cica, they have tonella coccidia, and they cause all this blood and stuff to go inside. This is a Nicatrix one. We call that salt and pepper because it has light and dark spots, and you can see it right through the intestinal wall. That's all blood, and that's what the inside looks like. So if you see blood in the manure, they might have coccidia or a very, very bad case of worms if you see blood from that. Okay. Now let's get on to worms and the treatment for it. This is how you treat. For the large intestinal roundworms, ascarids, this is what they look like. I showed you the picture before. They're going to decrease egg production. They're going to look pale. They're going to look droopy. They don't do very good. The treatment. The only legal treatment is this one right here called piperazine. Okay. These other ones, albendazole, fenbendazole, which is also called panicure, or levamazole and ivermectin, they are not labeled for chickens. If you have a vet that you know, though, and you have a problem with worms, especially with tapeworms if they get diagnosed through the manure, then you can get your vet to write a prescription and you can get this. Okay, but that's the only way they can use them. That's called extra label use because they've never been tested or gone through the USDA and FDA approval process. Why? Because it's very, very expensive. And two, most of the chickens in the United States are reared inside, and they're reared in cages, and they don't get worms. So they're not going to spend millions of dollars testing a product for a few backyard, well, it's more than a few now. There's lots of backyard people, but the numbers of chickens don't approach the billions that you get on the other side. So maybe someday they'll approve some other dewormers, but right now piperazine's it. And this is how you do it. You take the birds off water for the night before you're going to treat. Then the next day, you give them the piperazine-treated water, 1 ounce per gallon. Okay? They get that for the next day, up to 24 hours. Then the day after that, you put them on regular water, and you repeat this process 14 to 21 days later. And if you do this whole process twice a year, generally, you do it in the spring just after the first thaw, and then in the fall after the first hard freeze, that keeps your birds pretty clean. Backyard birds, or birds in a coop that you walk in from the outside and you bring eggs in on your shoes, even birds in a floor coop, okay, or outside, they can potentially get worms, and you want to keep them thrifty. Okay. Now, the other thing, some people want to use diatomaceous earth as a wormer. It kind of works a little bit. It's not highly effective, but it works. Other people have also used vinegar in the water, 5% vinegar solution. They think it works. It helps a little bit, but it's not a real treatment. I don't have any scientific research that says that they work or they don't work. The principle behind DE, and it has to be food grade. You can't just use pool grade DE. Diatomaceous earth that's food grade is very, very fine, but it's a silica compound, and it's very, very sharp edges, and supposedly if it gets into the worm, it cuts them up and kills them. That depends on them eating them and working with it. They also use DE in dust baths for external parasites, okay, for the external parasites. Now, for the external parasites, I didn't really tell you a treatment for that. The best treatment out there right now for the external parasites, for lice and mites, okay, on the birds, is a compound called 7, S-E-V-I-N, 7 compound. It's carbamate. That works pretty good, okay, and it's very, very safe. That can be used for pretty much all the lice and mites external on the bird. There is one mite that you won't see during the daytime. It's called the chicken mite. It's a little red one. That jumps off the bird during the day into the litter and into the coop in the wood. And then it comes on the bird at night when the lights are out and feeds at the bird at night. So you see little scars and little blood spots on them. And then you got to look for bugs and you don't see them. That's because they're only there at night. So you have to go a couple hours after lights out with a flashlight, shine it on the bird, look through the feathers, and if you see little bugs moving, now you know you got the chicken mite and you have to treat. Again, you can use 7 in there or any other permethrin type spray. That works really good. You can use the 7 as a dust in the dust box or in their dusting box, whatever they use for dust bathing, and you can put a little bit of 7 in each of the nest boxes where the birds go lay, and then they get it on them and helps get rid of them. The other common problem, okay, it's about a 5% dusting powder, by the way. Okay, you want it 5% dusting or liquid, okay? And that can be bought at pretty much any store. They use the same stuff. They use the dusting powder on tomatoes and other plants. That works pretty good. 7 is not approved for organic production, okay? There's very few drugs that are approved for organics, okay? So that's why they use the diatomaceous earth, or they use other products. Okay, there are some they call natural botanicals that are out there that are made from plants that are like a permethrin or pyrethrin product that are natural, and I think some of those are approved for organic production, but they keep changing the organic rules, so I'm not sure what's still legal and what isn't anymore. If you have a product and you're not sure, email me with that and I'll see if I can figure it out. So that's the treatment for parasites, internal and external. That's pretty much what you do. Then there's one other parasite that you might get. These are some more worms. Is something called scaly leg mite. Some of you might have had that. Generally, what I use, and this may sound a little funny, but what I use is you dip the leg in a can of gasoline, okay, and then you hold it in there for about 45 seconds, and then you pull it out, let it air dry. Once the legs are dry, then you slather on some petroleum jelly, like a Vaseline, or A and D ointment, the capital A and capital D ointment. That's a good vitamin A and D ointment, to call it. That's good for healing the skin, and it also keeps the air out. The idea here is you've got these little mites that go up underneath the scales, and they start camping out under there. They start irritating the birds, and it really hurts them. Okay, so for that, the gasoline is a very good drying agent. If you don't want to do it fast, if you're not worried about how fast you get rid of them, then just slather Vaseline on constantly and suffocate those little mites as best you can. And for the gasoline, I recommend if you have a bad case of scaly leg mites, you'll know if the scales are really up and bad on both legs. You dip them on day one, then use Vaseline several times a day for the next couple of days, and on day three, you dip them again in the gasoline, and that's the final treatment, and that should get rid of all of them. Okay, it dries them out really well. Okay, so that's it on some of the internal external parasites. I put some stuff up here to show you how worms go. This is some tapeworms, nasty little boogers. Okay, gapeworms. We don't see a lot of these in chickens. The gape type worms. They're tracheal worms. I also call them. We see this more in pheasants and game birds. So if anyone has pheasants or game birds, fenbendazole has been approved for use in game birds. So you can use that. And you can get that either into the feed or you can get a liquid. It It's also called Panacure or Safeguard. That's the other names for fenbendazole, Panacure or Safeguard. Okay. The other ones, you can use Tramazole or Levamazole. They also work pretty good. Again, Tramazole is approved for chickens and poultry. Levamazole, some products are, some aren't. So you have to kind of check and see the label, what it says for poultry or not. Again, I talked about the leg mites. You want to keep them clear. Here's what they look like. Scaly leg mites, depluming mites. Keep them clean. Clean out your area. If you have them, you're going to have to clean out your whole coop and sanitize it and get rid of it. So this is what some of the mites look like. Again, you can look at these later in more detail, because I'm sure it's what you want to think about just last thing at night. Here's that northern fowl mite, little tiny things. They get on the birds. They're on 24/7. If these little things look like a piece of dust that's moving, again, get your 7 or get something on there. The louse, here's what they look like. So let's finish up here on cleaning, disinfection, and biosecurity. When you do that, you want to dry clean first. Use your broom, use your vacuum, whatever. Get everything out as much as you can, because most disinfectants do not work through organic matter. You've got to get it cleaned up first. Then you do your soap and water cleaning. Don't be afraid of a little elbow grease. High-pressure sprayers work pretty good, but sometimes they don't get the cracks and crevices as good as you can when you have a brush and you're really direct contact with it. And then follow your label directions for what type of disinfectants. We have all these different types, the quats, the phenols, hypochlorites, or the chlorine. In other words, you're using your Clorox and mixing usually about a tablespoon per gallon as that, okay? So you want to use that and be careful with it. The next thing is biosecurity, like I talked about before. Keep in contact with other birds and no contact with people that have been around other birds. If you take birds to shows, have a quarantine area. When you bring your bird back from a show, quarantine it for 2 weeks, keep an eye on it. We've had lots of people come back from shows, especially like the big New England show up here at the Eastern States Fairgrounds. They bring their birds home, they either got scaly leg mites, or they got northern fowl mite, okay, or some of them come home with other diseases. There's just no way they can check every bird 100% and know that there's nothing on them coming into the show. They do the best job they can, but there's no guarantee. So I say quarantine your birds when you get them home. And the thing is that we've seen birds go from the backyard, kind of pasture raised for many, many years, and to a cage type system, and now the backyard type cage system. What's interesting about this is kind of what a commercial cage looks like. The door is open, the chickens aren't jumping out. Once they get used to where they live, that's where they live. So, anyway, I thought I'd leave with a little bit of fun. People complain about chickens being crowded, so you can read the joke and see what they say. And I like the end where it says, hey, what's good enough for the peasants is good enough for the chickens. Kind of a joke. So it's kind of a rush through, and that's a little longer than they anticipated for an hour. It's a lot of material to try to cover in a short time. I hope that I've given you some information. And like Jesse said, this is being recorded. This has a lot of information. You can go back over it several times. And I think Jesse will have my email. I don't think I put it on here, but I can put a comment up now, I guess, and add my email so you can get to it. How's that, Jeff?
Yeah, that would be great. Put your email up. And it looks like a few questions were missed, so I'm just going to try and go through. And also, if there are any lingering questions, go ahead and type them in the chat box, and we can try and cover them.
Okay.
One question.
Let me look at the chat
box. Someone was wondering about the net electric fencing that some people are using now for their poultry, the movable. Do you have any opinions on that and keeping predators out, keeping chickens in?
Yeah, it does a pretty good job. There's nothing 100%. Everything is going to reduce it, and that's the idea, is to reduce as best you can. The mesh or the netted stuff, is I like that better than single-strand wire. And the few pheasant farms and a couple of chicken farms I've seen it on, they say it's been pretty effective. So, again, what some of them do is they do that electric fencing, and then they put regular fencing behind it. So they kind of have a double barrier. I know it seems a little expensive and dramatic, but if you have predator problems, you want to do the best you can to keep them out.
There's also a question about misshapen eggs and what some possible causes for that could be.
Okay. Yeah, again, it depends. If your birds are coughing, sneezing, or wheezing, and you see them misshapen eggs, then you might have bronchitis. The other thing it comes from, if the birds are stressed a little bit, they may lay a soft-shelled egg. Okay, that's one without a shell on it, and it's like a membrane egg. If they're heat stress, cold stress, or a predator or something got in and scared them, they pop it out sooner than they need to, and that can cause that. Other misshapen, they're just occasionally, you know, the bird lays enough of them, you're going to get one that doesn't look right every once in a while, if you have enough. If you have a bird that's consistently laying misshapen eggs, then you have a genetic problem. So I hope that answers that.
And there are some questions here at the end here.
Let's see. Salmonella and layers. Oh, that's a good question. That's if you have your birds tested, if you come from an NPIP hatchery, okay, the chances of your birds having salmonella are pretty slim. However, that being said, salmonella is also out in the ground and carried by other wild animals. So if your birds are outside, they can be exposed to it. The chances of any one particular egg having any number of salmonella, but a salmonella bacteria is about 1 in 20,000. Okay, salmonella generally is in the digestive tract. However, if there's a high enough infestation or infection of it, they can migrate through the tract into the liver, into the spleen, and onto the ovary. And that's when it gets into the yolk. Generally, there's not a high number, and unless you're immunocompromised, you wouldn't get sick from eating one or two eggs that had salmonella. If you leave the eggs sit out at room temperature for a long period of time, which I'm saying more than 8 hours, then there's a chance that if there's salmonella, they will grow. And you have lots of them, and that's when people get sick, because they pool the eggs, they let them sit out, and the salmonella just increases. Generally, at 75 degrees Fahrenheit, they can double their population in every 6 to 8 minutes. So that's the problem with salmonella. Let's see, what else? Recommendation from dealing with roosters that are attacking when you approach the hens in the coop. It's called a kitchen broom in the face. So you get a kitchen broom, and you just push it in the face of that rooster enough times in his face, he'll stop coming at you. So that's what you have to watch out for. What toxic plants? It depends on where you live. I really don't know all the different toxins. Milkweed is a toxin. It has a latex in it. Poison ivy. Some chickens get poison ivy in their mouth and you react to it. Others don't. Those type of things. So you have to do is kind of, I would look with your plant people in your area. Ask your plant scientist what's potential in your area and how to identify them. Okay. Let's see. What can we build our flock with? Okay. Oh, the question here. You want to know, you have two hens and a rooster. Can we build our own flock with what we have? Do you recommend this? It depends on the breed you have and what you're trying to do with it. You can hatch your own if your hens go broody and they want to lay on the eggs and hatch them. That's a lot of people do that. You don't have to worry about vaccinations because they came from a clean flock of your own. You know what they're doing. I mean, that's where a lot of the heritage breeds and where a lot of the showbirds come from. They're not coming from commercial hatcheries. They're coming from people in backyards that have their own incubators or their own hens sitting on them, and then they propagate them that way, and generally they're not vaccinated. They build natural immunity, and some of them are pretty hardy and some of them aren't. So that's not a bad way to do it.
Mike, someone was asking, typed in earlier, how to support a broody hen, and I couldn't quite tell if it was... she wanted it to be broody and to support it laying on a nest, or how to get them to quit being broody, but maybe you can address both circumstances.
Yeah, I'll address both. Okay, broody, generally what they do is they'll go out of production if they're broody. If they're sitting on eggs or sitting on them, it generally takes 21 days to hatch the chicken eggs, so they need to be on them pretty much at that time. And they stop laying eggs when they do that, obviously, and then they don't eat a whole lot. They lose a little bit of body weight. Now, if you're trying to keep them broody, they want to be away from the other birds. They want to be secluded in a semi-dark area and safe from the other birds getting at them. So you almost want to put them in their own little pen and their own little nest box and have their own feeder and water if that's what you're trying to do, because the other ones will come in and try and sit on the eggs or move them and do things with it. That's that. Number two, if you have broody hens and you don't want them to be broody, then you need to do is kick them out of the nest boxes, put more light near the nest box so they don't hang out in there where it's dark thinking it's this fun place to hang out, and keep them moving. So what we do, once we collect eggs during the day, we pretty much close off our nest boxes until night when we want them to go back in if we don't want them hanging out if it's, you know, if there's a problem. That's one way of doing that. So other than that, it's just pretty much keep an eye on them and kick them out of the nest box when they're not laying an egg and being productive for you.
All right. Any last questions out there? I think we've done a great job covering a lot here. Thank you so much for being with us this evening. I do want to say to people who joined us a little later, please type your email address into the chat box. We can capture that and send you some follow-up information, including a PDF of this presentation. Also, this will be posted on our website, a recording of the presentation, and a PDF of this presentation. And so check back at the uvm.edu/newfarmer website, and we'll have that information up next week. And I think that wraps it up for us. Thank you so much for taking some time out this evening to be with us this evening, Mike.
You're welcome, Jesse, and to all the people that were here. I hope you got something out of it. And again, I put my email up, so contact me, and I'll get back to you as soon as I can. And you all have a good night.
All right, good night.